audience. And so we've gone through looking at microservices and service meshes. We've looked at domain-driven design, and now we and some principles. But now we're getting into almost like it's going to be almost like a use case, isn't it? We're looking at data, building data as a service, and data gateways for the hybrid cloud. So how all of this comes together, I guess. Is that right, Hugo?
Yes, exactly. So we will be talking about the different patterns on the gateways and how this relates with the API gateways, that how you can get all this mentioning on the anti-corruption layer and how to bridge the new world of the cloud with the old world of the on-premises.
Fantastic. Can you share your slide deck and then I'll get off the stage?
I hope now you're able to see my slides.
Yeah, that's perfect. I'll let you take it away. Thanks, Hugo.
Thank you, Mark. So let's talk about a little bit about data gateways and how to bridge and bring these data as a service on the hybrid cloud and bridge to these two domains. So a little bit introduction of myself. My name is Hugo. I'm a Mexican currently based in Massachusetts area in the United States. I do APIs and event-driven architecture, and I'm an open source advocate. I do also like history, travel, and food. So I consider myself an enthusiast. And I'm leaving here also my Twitter handler if you want to follow the conversation offline or you want to just reach and engage on this topic or any other of the topics that we talk about all the time. And for these following minutes, we will be talking about this evolution in the architecture, going from the ground to the cloud and the multi-cloud and how to get, beat some of the challenges that this kind of approaches and evolution present, as well as talking about specific on microservices data, what are the different changes and how can we get this race of the gateways. And finally, we'll go over the different gateways that we have available. We will be trying to cover some of the use cases that you can find with them and how to bridge them together. So at the beginning, we want to certainly talk about this kind of situation where if you're not a digital native, you find that your application has outgrown. It's this monolithic database and application that it's living in your data center, and perhaps it's not modular, it lacks agility. There's a lot of applications that are interconnected. And the most important thing is there are a lot of databases or even monolithic databases after several mergers and acquisitions are just outgrowing your internal processes. So what you want to do is you want to modernize this kind of architecture. So what can you do for that, right? There are different approaches and there are different ways to tackle this kind of solution. So according to the analysts, there are like three major ways to tackle this kind of challenges. The first one is just do a big bang replacement where you just rip off, remove everything, and then just move to the next big thing. However, there's obviously certain risk related to this kind of approach, right? And it's kind of difficult and so on. Then there's the other, it's like, there's just like only a greenfield tech stack and then you just start to move your whole services to the next stack. And that also has some drawbacks. And then the one in the middle, that's the one that we are gonna cover, is where you are able to, place them together and try to bridge the new approach, the new technological stack, what you already have in your current application, your current architecture. So this will certainly lower the risk on when how to continue with running the business with the same stack, and you at the same time still get all the benefits of being able to evolve your architecture towards a cloud native or a hybrid cloud approach. And this is because there's different kind of elements that are part of this concept of hybrid cloud, right? Obviously, we are here in Happy Days, and we know that Open API and the API specifications, and obviously the DDD design, is also part of this of this approach, of this way to reach those worlds. The automation on DevOps, also the container orchestration, allows you to be able to move your workloads from one from your on-premise data center to the cloud and other places. And microservices, well, it's a way to allow the different teams to continue to develop independently and move on. So this is our like different different aspects that you need to take into account when you're going to address this hybrid cloud challenge. And there's one specific point that perhaps is not well covered here, but it's mainly on a part of the microservices, and that is the data. That's the most complex part when doing microservices, if you have heard of this. And this is because most of the times we are challenging this kind of situation where we do have our super awesome modern type of architecture that is based on microservices. However, we still need to access, you know, our data that it's that has been, you know, managed and polished and fit from since the last, you know, 20 or 10 years or more, even in some cases. And it has all grown in these monolithic databases that sometimes they're very difficult to move on to the cloud. Certainly it will take a lot of effort because they're heavy, they're big, and you need to tackle them and take them down and being able to, you know, let the microservice architecture survive, right? And this is because the distributed architecture also has some challenges, right? And we will be talking about these two different type of challenges that we have seen when doing a distributed architecture. So the first ones, the ones in the left side where you can see the network challenges. So when we are distributing our application, when my components are being deployed in containers or as Kubernetes or even serverless environments, we need to connect them. We need to be able to route the traffic from my microfrontend or my frontend into the different services that are targeting my orders or my my payments and so on. And there's where some challenges, like for example, how do I do the discovery? How do I do load balancing? How do I redirect my calls to the to those places? What happens if some service is not available, like network resiliency, or the API governance? Which API should I be able to consume? In which one do I have access and permissions to query the information, and as well as monitoring and tracing to follow up what is the flow of that request at the network level or at the communication level, and then. When we are separating the microservices in different stores in the distributed architecture, then we also have the exact same type of challenges on the data access. For example, how do I do an abstraction on the storage layer? How do I audit the access control? How do I do replication and caching of my information? And how do I do data federation? So in the past, we did have some way to handle this. Yeah, they were the ESBs. However, the ESBs are not popular anymore, and most of you will be thinking like, we don't need ESBs. We are doing everything with microservices. However, the concept of integration or the enterprise integration patterns that we used to do inside the ESB, they are still required. You're still doing them every time you connect to another service. Or you do an aggregation or a composition of your API, you're doing integration. You're doing enterprise integration patterns. The difference is that now we have this, we're moving away from decentralized monolithic type of ESB, and then we're now deploying those as a logic in our services. And this is where things like the API gateway pattern raise, right? So this is something that it's most of the time accepted and implemented in field, right? Where you have this API gateway pattern that it's this component that allows you to interface between the consumer applications and your backend services. And the gateway produces certain benefits, right? As part of the implementation, you are able to implement control access to your services. You are able to route those services. So it's basically tackling the challenges that we found at the network level. The API gateway helps us to do that. And the API gateways now also have evolved from decentralized type of big API gateway into a more decentralized distributed gateways, where you can have multiple gateways running at the same time, being coordinated from a central control plane and just working as data planes into your distributed microservice architecture, even interacting with things like the service mesh. In the case of the microservices data, again, we do have microservices that now are having this distributed database or a database per microservice approach, where you have an independent database instance that it's just serving that specific microservice. And then you can do that as like having one instance per service, or you can just isolate the different data in one instance through schemas or logical grouping of tables in one specific table. But the idea is that only one microservice owns the data. You don't have access directly to the data, but you need to access the information through that microservices that knows what is the actual implementation that you require on the data. Most of the times you access this through the API that's exposed by that service. And this is because now we have this explosion of the different persistent layers for your data implementation. You have NoSQL, traditional SQL, document databases, and it's going to be super complicated for your application to be able to access directly the persistent ledger. It's going to be easier if you do it through the microservice. So in this way, gateways are able to having some feature that will tackle the challenges. So if we go back to our diagram in our distributed architecture, we will see that we have the API gated features that tackle the networking challenges, where you can implement abstraction, where you can do API first development with a contract. You can do some load balancing and network resiliency. You can implement those within your API gateway. And also, you can do access control, traffic encryption, and a little bit more of authentication and authorization. In the other side, we have the data gateway features, where you can do, again, data source abstraction and federation. You can do modeling and shaping of your data, so you can do some certain type of transformations, as well as use it as a data firewall, where you can apply role-based access control, but based on the structure of the data, being able to mask fields, allow access just to certain rows or certain columns in your data. Basically, a data gateway is like an API gateway, but it understands and acts on the data layer implementation rather than the network layer. So it knows what is the shape of your payload and acts on that specific model or data model. It allows you to handle all the different features at that level. So if we see a diagram, this is how it looks like. It's very similar like an API gateway. The only difference is that instead of having services, you have data stores or persistent stores, where you have relational databases, even other APIs, so you can transform from an API to a different protocol or non-relational data stores. And the idea is that on the other side, perhaps with the API gateway, you used to have mainly protocols like HTTP or certain other protocols. In the case of the data gateway, what you want to implement is the data transport and access protocols like ODBC, for example, for your BI type of structure. So you want to allow people to just do a connection through JDBC and be able to use SQL to be able to access those services. More modern type of approach, just with an API that's based on REST or OData for the case of access, like, for example, SAP, and now more modern approach like GraphQL. So what we're looking into a data gateway is to have this kind of capabilities. So being able to allow to have this abstraction and decoupling from the implementation details. So I will expose my table, for example, or the structure of my data without having to force the client to be able to know what kind of implementation detail I do have. Like if there's a Postgres database or my SQL database, it doesn't matter. They will certainly find the exact same way to access any type of implementation. So it abstracts the physical source that it's providing the information of my data. Also, you can, as I mentioned, add some security on top of that, that it's based on the data model. So you can mask, just select certain rows or columns at the authentication level without going into the details of the implementation in the database, right? So you don't want to add more users to your database because it's being managed by a different entity. You can use the data gateway to add those credentials on the authentication layer and then just externalize that information. So for example, using OpenID Connect for that. You can do scaling if you are able to have materialized views or just use it as cache. If your database perhaps it's having too much load for information that can be cached, then the data gateway can implement modern ways to implement a very cheap way to access a cache and then maybe to use it. Federation, if you want to get information from different sources, and obviously using traditional ways to access data like through the SQL standard, it's going to be easier than make your application talk different protocols that are coming with modern applications. And there are different types of data gateways, right? There's the first category, for example, of data gateways can be the traditional data virtualization platforms like Denodo or TIBCO or Composite. In the case of the database, for example, Postgres implements the ANSI SQL MED specification that is a standardized way of handling access to remote objects for SQL databases. And compared with the traditional data virtualization, there's a new category of data gateways focused around the web access data, the web-based data access, like, for example, Hashura, Prisma, or Space Optics. They're using GraphQL to access this abstraction. In the case of the cloud-hosted databases, data gateways, Apache Drill, it's a free schema SQL query engine for NoSQL. PrestoDB, it's another popular database. TIF, that is a project sponsored by Red Hat, it's also a way to implement this kind of open source databases. In the case of the cloud databases, AWS Athena or Redshift Spectrum and also BigQuery are similar ways to handle these kind of gateways. And for other types, there's Azure on-premise data gateway if you want to do the secure tunneling data proxies. The Google's Cloud SQL proxy, it's another one. And my favorite, it's Scopper. It's a project that allows you to be able to access your APIs if they are local, and not just APIs, basically any type of TCP communication that is running on Kubernetes, you're able to find it anyways. And we will talk about that in this moment. So Scopper, it's a project that is implementing what we call the virtual application network. So when we're talking about data gateways, one of the most common challenges is that my data is living on my data center and I need to access that from my cloud, or I need to present that into another different cluster running on even different clouds, right? So the virtual application network is this abstraction layer on top of the network that allows you to deploy your application across all the different type of network implementation. So you're able to access not only HTTP, but gRPC, messaging, general TCP. And it's a nice fit for Kubernetes, where you have this concept of services that abstract the actual implementation or pods where your application is running. So in this way, you're able to your application topology independently from the network topology. So you will see an application that is running across the different clouds, your on-premise or multiple clouds, and being able to access that. So in that way, you don't need to replicate data, but you can just tunnel that information through the network. And this is how the Scopper project works, right? So it's this virtual application network that is running some proxies that are doing the implementation details of the services that are available in each one of the network clusters, and then allows you to have these virtual address destinations where you can access, like they're running on your service, and then the virtual application network will route the traffic to the different locations. So you will be able to implement things interesting, like, for example, a fan-out approach where you can send a request that is then directed to two or more different clouds and then be able to get a response from that. And when we're talking about data gateways, we have different patterns, right? We are able to solve certain use cases. Like, for example, we want to implement data governance with or secure data gateway. where you can have these virtual databases and your services accessing that database, that virtual database, and then at the end being able to control the access or just limit the access to the real implementation database. So in this case, you can evolve your microservices, have a different control without even touching your application. Other use case is the federation and abstraction. So you have your consumption layer, you have enterprise layer, and you can just add up, enrich your content from the different implementations and create and shape your own data models where you can then be able to access that information. And one of the use case that I like most is the via an open banking model where you have all these anti-corruption layer components that allows you to have these intelligent proxies that allows you to route your information from the customer devices, from your open APIs, and from your external services or third-party services through your different components, and then being able to have these virtualized services or just having transformation layers where you can still access the core banking or decentralized pieces of your architecture. And finally, just to get a little bit closer to the end, so data has gravity. So that's why it's very difficult just to move it around different clouds. So when everybody wants to say, like, I want to go from the ground to the cloud and move all the way up, it's very difficult for data because it's heavy. It's difficult to move easily. It's like the mammoth that we saw in the slide before. And most of the time, you want to have granular access. You want to scale it. However, if you are still attached to these traditional implementations, it's going to be either difficult or it's going to be very expensive to scale, right? So it's difficult to move. And what we can do when having the data gateway is being able to, you know, get the benefits of the cloud native assets and tooling, creating these hybrid layers where you can get the benefits of the scaling and distributing at the gateway level that acts as just a proxy to your implementation details on the cloud. So most of the times, you will see the race of these components where you will certainly need to have a data gateway to be able to provide multiple access. I hope you like this session. Here's again my digital handler. If you want to follow up the conversation, have any questions, or just check out the content. And here's also my YouTube video where I post some videos around tutorials and how to deal with APIs and messaging. So thank you very much, Mark. I don't know if there's any question.
There is, Hugo. That was really fantastic. Thank you. Scupper.io is one that will be really interesting for people to follow up with, I'm sure. And I mean, just the level of your knowledge around all the different types of databases that people could apply. So I'd encourage our viewers to follow up with you to talk about how you decide on, you know, some of those database software decisions, I guess, you know. In the meantime, just one quick one before we break because we're a little bit over. But Marwan has asked, what's the difference between a gateway pattern and a facade pattern, as both do hide the complexity from the to the consumer? So is there a difference between, when you talked about gateway patterns, you talked about facade patterns, what's the difference there?
Well, one of the things that I see that the gateway adds or sum ups is that it allows you to do the control access, right? And it's one of the implementations that you can do at the gateway level, where you are not only just, you know, doing the abstraction and the implementation details and that we are exposing, but also you are taking some steps forward on the transformation and the access control.
Okay, fantastic. So then also
basically it's an extension of the same pattern.
That's, yeah, right. Okay, great. There is another question around that, which unfortunately we won't have time for, so I'd ask if it's possible, could you maybe put your slide deck, if it's available, because there was so much detail in there, if you could put that up as a link and then also respond to Marwan's other question in the stage chat over the break. And if anyone else hasn't typed fast enough, feel free to add some questions there, and the presenters will see them in, during the break. But thanks again, Hugo, for being part of API Days and for the presentation.
Anytime. I really enjoyed this. Have a nice
day. No, it was. You can tell because there was just so much detail. I was taking notes, and it's hard to keep up. There was so much in there. It was great. Thanks a lot.